Welcome. My name is Joe Meister. I am the Communications Director for Institute for Systems Biology, ISB. And this is a video chat with Professor Sui Huang, MD, PhD. Dr. Huang is a molecular biologist and in his current research seeks to integrate big data with complex systems theory to better understand diseases. He has been a member of ISB's faculty for more than a decade and he runs the Huang Lab. Systems biology integrates many disciplines from the molecular to the clinical level, and hence may offer a perspective that few of you have heard when epidemiologists and clinicians are interviewed by the media. Dr. Huang recently wrote and published an article titled COVID-19, Why We Should All Wear Masks, There is a New Scientific Rationale. His article has been seen by more than 1.5 million people, and he is a very important voice in a growing chorus of experts suggesting that masks become a tool in the toolbox when it comes to flattening the curve of the coronavirus pandemic. Dr. Huang, thank you for taking part in this video Q&A.
Thank you for having me.
So let's jump right in with our first question. So early recommendations were to not wear masks, and reasons included one, a shortage of masks, that a mask worn by a citizen means a mask that a health professional wouldn't have. And two, masks aren't an effective way to prevent coronavirus. Your recommendations run counter to earlier statements made by the CDC and other public health agencies. Can you explain that?
Yeah, that's very unfortunate messaging because it's contradictory, right? So why would you tell people not to wear masks because we need it? And so there are subtleties here that one has to consider. Of course, the true reason is because the health care professionals are much more exposed. But that gives, unfortunately, the impression that masks are totally useless, which is not the case, and we will see. So that's one contradiction or apparent contradiction that confuses people. The second contradiction that just came up recently, and that is CDC and WHO are trying to push the idea that COVID-19 is not an airborne disease, not airborne, but mediated by contact and big droplets. If that's the case, then you don't even need these sophisticated N95 masks, which are designed to filter out airborne small particles. So if COVID-19 is, you know, contact mediated, you know, through the big droplets that you sneeze out, then masks should be very effective. So it was a contradiction in the messages. It was also counterintuitive, and that was really confusing.
So your recommendation is that everyone should be wearing a mask, correct?
Yeah, people, you know, you hear so much and so much effort now in social media to make masks and wear masks. That's just your normal gut reaction, intuition. It actually makes sense. So let me explain why it makes sense and why we keep hearing there's no evidence that masks are protective. Actually, there's also no evidence that washing hands and all these things are useful. If you look through the literature, and I just did that, meta studies, so studies, looking at many, many studies show that it's very hard to find evidence in the case of influenza that washing your hands are effective. So if we take a step back in medicine, what does a medical fact, what does it constitute? What do you need to establish a medical fact? So you need two pillars to establish the correctness of a medical fact. One is empirical evidence, so you observe in real life, or you conduct ideally a randomized control trial, RCT, where you let people wear masks or not wear masks, and you try. So these are empirical evidence, very hard to get, very hard to conduct. The second pillar of a medical truth is a plausible mechanistic explanation, which sometimes is hard because it involves chemistry and biochemistry, but sometimes it's easy because it involves just mechanics. And I think we have such a case now. So the mechanics of transmission of COVID, if what we know is true, is that when you sneeze and cough, you expel large droplets come out of your mouth with a muscle velocity of up to, you know, 10, 20, 50 meters per second and can reach 5-6 meters. So 20 feet or so, much more than the recommended 6 feet. And so it's a very mechanical, simple explanation. Again, it's a plausible mechanistic explanation, and there's no, we don't have much evidential support, but it makes sense. And it also makes sense in view of recommended, you know, what is called respiratory etiquette, where you have to, you know, sneeze in your elbow. If that is protective, then a mask should be protective. And it also tells you that you don't need the sophisticated N95 respirator, but anything, any physical barrier should be helpful. And if that's true, then that explanation that you don't want to cause a shortage for health professionals is just not a good argument, because everybody could take their home, anything that protects, like these things here, right? Any scarf in Seattle. Mm-hmm. And that protects, because masks are very important and very, very effective in a sense that if you act out of fear and out of sense to protect yourself, you actually also protect others. So it's a bi-directional protection, it's a barrier. And that makes it much more effective than gloves or any other, you know, etiquette of coughing and sneezing into your hands.
Great. So you had mentioned the N95 respirator mask. All masks are not alike. What are the differences between the N95 surgical masks and do-it-yourself or DIY masks? You know, you just held up your scarf. You know, what are the differences between all these?
Well, N95 were designed and, you know, to protect or to filter out very fine droplets, tiny ones, 10 micron droplets, or even less, that go deep into your lung. And they are electrostatic, so that's why they wear off, you cannot wear them again, but cloth masks, and so they work through mechanical blocking of large droplets, like 0.1 millimeter or larger, and they actually maintain the protective effect, even if much lower than that of the respiratory mask. They maintain that at least longer. They don't decay over time. And what we now also know, just last week or so, and also a paper coming out this week in Nature, suggests that with COVID-19, the site of action is in your nose and in your throat. That's where the virus lands, that's where the receptors of the virus are, and that's also where the cells are in which the virus replicates. And we find like 1,000 times more COVID-19 virus than in the case of SARS and so. So it's really something that occurs here in your nasal pharynx, and the pulmonary consequences, you know, pneumonia and so, it's actually a later complication. And so you sneeze out and you cough out the virus at a very high extent. That's why it's so contagious. And that's also why a simple mechanical barrier might help dramatically.
And to just to clarify, we're talking about, you know, a scarf, a bandana, a surgical mask, a barrier like that. You're saying that that with the cells in your nose, as we're finding, that's what happens. The N95 mask isn't necessarily required, correct?
Yeah. So the N95. Well, you also produce aerosols, but much less, and human anatomy is not good at producing fine aerosols. Aerosols are produced by machines like flushing of your toilet or, you know, these hand blowers to dry your hands. They produce tons of aerosols, or respirators, dental drills, and those high-powered, high-frequency machines produce aerosols. That's why healthcare professionals are more exposed to aerosols. But in the outer, you know, environment, you should protect yourself against larger droplets.
Great. So if people don't have access to these surgical masks, we have talked about using a scarf, bandana, towel, you know, things like that. One question that we've received for this video Q&A was, how can we make viable, inexpensive masks at home? What materials are needed? How can you test the effectiveness? And what, you know, filter mesh size should be standard? How would you respond to questions like that?
I'm not expert in that. I've seen so many recipes, but just now, a few hours ago, it was in New York Times, you know, probably seen a very detailed recipe how to make them. But I think it's, we should focus on mechanical blocking of droplets, so any cloth, multiple layer would do it. And also the structure should be such that you can remove easily and wash them easily. So I think that's important. And to plug in my cord.
So let's get back to the article that you wrote on Medium. Are there examples of countries whose populace did wear masks, and what was the outcome?
Yeah, that's, I was trying to get data for that, and some people have done that. You know, Asian countries wear much more masks. Some are mandated, and in Taiwan, they actually actively distribute simple surgical masks or even an N95 mask. And as you know, in Asian countries, the curve is flatter, and they also manage to flatten the curve. I think yesterday, Austria also issued this requirement to wear a mask if you go to the grocery store. And that's important because social distancing is just one part of the strategy to flatten the curve, right? And if you do social distancing, there's still the weakest link that is left open, that is when people go out to do grocery, when they have to take elevators with other people, and everybody is now on trails, you know, where they cross each other much closer than the 6 feet. And so in those circumstances, I think a mask still helps because it's closed the remaining gap.
Now, you wrote wearing masks has been stigmatized in America and in other Western countries. Any ideas on how to resolve that stigma?
Yeah, I mean, I think social media is not trying to counter that, make it fun, have, you know, make mask a fashion statement, or put some funny thing on your mask. So many ways to do that. I think whether it's a stigma or not just depends on the culture, right? And just being actively stigmatized by some of the officials. So view it as a sign of solidarity, of awareness, and that we are in this together. And I think that would help.
Mm-hmm. So changing gears a little bit, switching gears a little bit, what efforts are you taking to change public health policy? What actions are you taking to try to get this message out?
Well, I think I've been contacted by many to help. There's so many efforts already. As I said, just intuitively, it makes sense to wear a mask. At least it doesn't hurt. It's better. It's a mechanical additional layer. Some people point to some danger associated with masks because you touch your face. And also educate people that you shouldn't touch your face. Other people say you touch your face much less. But I think the message is out there. People know it. Many people know, so many people making masks now. So I think the remaining message to get out is to have ways to discard them, to wash them properly. And I think that's the remaining, you know, if there is a risk and if you want it to not hurt, but at least help a bit, then we have to be sure that people handle masks correctly. And so I try to educate at that front.
Mm-hmm. So your article on Medium, that received a lot of support and some fallout. What are the chief complaints that you've been hearing and reading since publishing your article, and how do you respond to them?
Actually, very few complaints, so I was surprised. Some people say that want to also emphasize hand washing and disinfection of surfaces, which I didn't do because I want to focus on masks. But think about that. So why do we disinfect surfaces and clean and wipe out everything? Because of droplets that contain the virus. And where do they come from? They have to come from somewhere, and they come from somebody sneezing. And if you have a mask, you don't sneeze onto surfaces, onto public surfaces. So everything is connected. And I think the best thing is those different measures we can take are not mutually exclusive. They synergize. And if we apply them together, then probably we have the most effect on flattening the curve.
Fantastic. Dr. Huang, this is excellent information. Do you have anything to add before we sign off? Anything you want to mention?
No, I think that's it. So there's a solid science behind, but it's also a solid intuition. I just wish that we start now wearing masks, or if you don't have, just wear something like that tonight. Helps a lot.
And go Sounders, right?
Yes, go Sounders.
Okay, Dr. Huang, thank you very much for your time and your expertise. We appreciate it.
Thank you.